Hello, welcome to this webinar offered through DAIReXNET, which is a national e-extension resource. My name is Kathy Lee. I'm an extension educator with Michigan State University, and I'll be today's moderator. So let me introduce today's speaker. Dr. Chad Dechow is an associate professor in the Department of Animal Science at Penn State University. He has been at the university since 2003 and has a teaching and research appointment with a focus on dairy cattle genetics. Dr. Dechow grew up on a small dairy farm in Southwest New York. His undergraduate education was at the State University of New York, Morrisville, and Cornell University. He earned his master's degree in animal science from Penn State University and his PhD in animal science from the University of Tennessee. The primary focus of his research program is improving dairy cow health and well-being while breeding for higher levels of milk production efficiency. You may also recognize his name as a regular author for the Hordes Dairyman magazine.
Well, thank you so much, Kathy, for that introduction. And I also want to thank those that are joining us here today to discuss sire selection. The stuff that I'm going to present today isn't necessarily brand new exciting research, but just more of a refresher now that we've kind of come through the era of genomics and have incorporated genomics, kind of gets you to thinking a little bit about where we stand. And really, I'm targeting this more toward commercial producers than those that are involved in marketing and trying to develop the next great bull. So let's go ahead and get started here. And these are kind of some of the main ideas I'll be talking about. We'll talk a little bit about how genomics has been adopted. I'm going to present a little bit on the concept of genetic progress versus genetic lag, and maybe try to correct a subtle misperception about genetic progress. Talk a little bit about selection indexes and then breeding for healthier cows. So I first wanted to start out and just give a little bit of an update on the amount of genotyping that is now being done by dairy producers. And as you can see, in this left-hand panel, we've got the number of cows and heifers and heifer calves that are being genotyped on a monthly basis. And that number has grown until, for the last year, we've been fairly stable at about 25,000 cows, heifers, and calves a month being genotyped, at least for Holsteins. And whether that leveling out will stay there or perhaps a little bit lower milk prices have caused people to hold back just a little bit, it remains to be seen over time, but we're still about 25,000 per month for Holsteins. Jerseys are more about 3,000 per month, 3,000 cows genotyped per month. And then on the male side, we had this initial, when we launched genomics in 2009, huge number of bulls were tested, and then since that time, we've leveled out to about 2,500 Holstein bulls and about 250 to 300 Jersey bulls per month that are genotyped. So in the big effect that this has had is that our generation interval has declined dramatically. So this was, here's the average age when a bull's sons were born. Okay, and you can see they were on average 7 years old for AI sires, and that by 2013 had been basically halved. And if we follow this trend line out, we're now at the point where here in 2015 where most AI bulls are about 2 to 2.5 years old when their sons start to enter AI, or when their sons that will be in AI are born at least. And cows were doing a lot more in vitro fertilization and embryo transfer for these, some of these elite lines as well, so that's also down here in the 2.5 year point or so. So really that's been the biggest impact of genomics, is what we're using elite sires when they're quite a bit younger. So in the end, genomics really didn't shift the number of bulls that are entering artificial insemination. What it has done is changed how we've used them. So we're using bulls when they're quite a bit younger than we have in the past. Our generation interval is halved for our sires, and also for our dams it's quite a bit lower, and you'll see in a little bit how that is expected to accelerate the rate of genetic progress. So in this chart here, at the top, we've got our genetic response formula. And what this tells us is that the rate of genetic progress is a function of reliability, selection intensity, which is basically how picky are we? Are we going to use the best 1 in 10 bulls for a given trait or the best 1% of the population for a given trait? The genetic standard deviation, which is just a function of the population and the genes in the population, and not really something that we can change. Some traits have a lot of genetic variation, some traits have less. And then all that is divided by the generation interval. So we've moved our generation interval on the sires from almost 7 years now down to 2 to 2.5 years. So you can see how that would really expect to accelerate our rate of genetic progress if we reduce that generation interval. So, but one of the points that I want to make, and that we don't make often enough, is that that formula really only applies to the elite herds that are marketing and that are providing bulls to the AI industry. Okay, so this blue line here really represents those herds. So this is lifetime net merit from 1975 to 2013 and how it's changed. So for animals that are born during those years. And you can see the sire breeding value, these are our elite herds, that's gone up quite a bit over time. And you can see that starting in 2009, there does look to be a little bit of an uptick in the pace of genetic progress for lifetime net merit. That was due to the introduction of genomics. So what happens is that these elite herds make this fast genetic progress by using genomic young sires and doing in vitro fertilization and using the best bulls. And then the herds that use artificial insemination, so they're using sires from these elite herds, are then pulled along at the same pace. So this red line here represents the cow breeding value for lifetime net merit. And these are basically commercial cows. So you can see there's really not a difference in how quickly our blue line and our red line are increasing, but there is a lag. And that's usually about 5 years or so between our blue line and our red line. And really, all commercial herds that they're using artificial insemination are improving at the same rate. What's different and where sire selection becomes important is how far behind the elite herds they lag. Herds that are using kind of lousy bulls are going to have a longer lag period, and so they're going to be falling. They're not falling behind, but they're just behind their commercial, the herds that they're competing with a little bit. Whereas other herds, maybe they're doing using the very best bulls available. They might do a little bit of embryo transfer and in vitro fertilization. They've shortened that lag a little bit. And so they're above the typical commercial herd. So they're all increasing at the same rate. It's just a matter of how far behind, how many years you lag the elite artificial insemination herds. Unfortunately, lag works in both directions. So the good herds have pulled us up for milk yield in particular and protein yield and so forth. But in this chart, we see what's happened on the negative side since 1960 or so. The elite artificial insemination herds that provide these sires were kind of dragging the commercial cow population represented here in blue down with them. But since 2009, we've started to see a little bit of a turnaround, and now our sires in our elite AI population is beginning to pull our cows up a little bit, and I expect that trend to continue over time. So when we think about genetic progress and lag, the rate of progress from 1 year to the next is the same for elite breeders and the commercial population. However, the commercial population is going to lag behind a little bit. And how far they lag behind depends on some of the same factors that determine the rate in the elite herds. So generation interval is part of this, reliability, how many bulls we select to use after they've gone through that initial progeny test period, and the rate of progress in the elite population. So what this means for commercial herds is that good bulls are good bulls. If you are an elite producer that's trying to market and generate the next $1 million bull or the next $100,000 cow, you have to use genomic young sires. You really almost don't have a choice. On the other hand, if you're a commercial producer just trying to do your best to keep up, you're using genetics from those elite $1 million bulls in your herds, so you're going to be pulled along at the same pace. So in the end, the choice between genomic young sire and mature bull isn't necessarily as critical as maybe some people believe, because you're going to be pulled along at the same pace either way. The other thing that happens a little bit is that mature bulls make more semen than young bulls. So those elite genomic young sires, sometimes it's the semen's either a little too expensive for a commercial producer to use, or it's just simply not available. So what ends up happening is that some of our commercial producers end up using kind of middle-of-the-road young bulls rather than a really good mature bull. And what I want to encourage you today is that you're better off using a really good mature bull than a middle-of-the-road young bull. So let's just to demonstrate what I'm talking about here, I want to compare two groups of bulls. The first group of bulls is our young sires. Excuse me, sorry about that. That were born 2008 to 2009, and so they did not have any daughters in 2012. But then they had at least 100 daughters in 2015. And I want to compare what would happen if in 2012 you used those bulls versus proven bulls that had 100 daughters in 2012 and that were born between 2000 and 2007. And what we're going to do here is we're going to compare if we use the top quarter of daughter pregnancy rate bulls versus the top 10% of daughter pregnancy rate bulls from the proven side. So what I'm showing you here is a scenario where the good young bulls aren't making quite enough semen and it costs a little bit too much, so you go a little bit further down the list versus what would have happened if you used a really good proven bull. Okay, and then we're going to do the same thing for protein yield with a slightly higher. We'll look at the top 10% versus the top 5% of our proven bulls. And this is what you would have achieved for daughter pregnancy rate. So on our left here are our young sires as of 2012, and on our right are our proven bulls as of 2012. And then the blue bars here represent their daughter pregnancy rate based on their 2012 genetic evaluation, and the red, their daughter pregnancy rate based on their 2015 genetic evaluation. And you can see that basically, we're about plus 2% for daughter pregnancy rate for our top young sires. But because we are able to be just a little bit more picky, if we're picking from the top 10% for our proven bulls, we're actually plus 3 for daughter pregnancy rate. So under that scenario, the commercial producer was actually better off in that case to have used the top proven bulls rather than middle-of-the-road young sires. We see the exact same thing when we look at protein yield. Okay, you can see our young sires and our proven bulls in 2012 fairly similar because we're picking from the top 5% for our proven versus the top 10% for our young sires, so we're being a little bit pickier. Both groups of bulls were supposed to be about 40 pounds better than average for protein. And in 2015, now that these bulls actually have daughters, we can look and see, and our proof held up fairly well, about 36 pounds. Our proven bulls did not drop quite as much, but still a little bit of a slip down to about 40 pounds. So again, we would have been better off in that scenario to use proven bulls rather than young sires. So I want to emphasize, I'm not suggesting here that using daughter-proven bulls will always outperform using young sires. But what I do want to emphasize is that the reverse is not at all true. There's been this perception that because of generation interval, everybody should be using young sires, and if you're not using a young bull, then you're falling further behind. that's just simply not true because of the amount of semen that proven bulls produce, and because those proven bulls have been through an extra step of selection in the process. So if you're trying to market the newest genetics, then yes, you've got to use young sires. If you're a commercial producer, you just need to use good bulls, and whether it's a good young bull or a good older bull isn't nearly as important. Okay, so now I want to turn my attention a little bit to how many traits we evaluate, and to me, this is one area where things fall apart a little bit on commercial herds, because we evaluate bulls for more than 40 traits. This gets to be kind of time-consuming if you're trying to sort through all these 40 traits from 100 different bulls. And it's also quite easy to lose focus on the most important traits. And I think what happens is that sometimes commercial producers look at all these numbers and they kind of lose interest a little bit and just let the AI technician put semen in the cows because they're not interested in really paying attention to all of those numbers. And that's perfectly understandable because they've got a lot of other things going on. And the reality is because they're using AI sires, they're going to be pulled along and not do terribly with that approach anyway. But there is an opportunity to do even a little bit better. I've even put down here some registered breeders are now even looking at chromosome by chromosome PTAs. So we've got 40 different traits, and we could look at their PTA for 30 different chromosomes. And not only that, we can break it down into what a cow inherited from their sire and what a cow inherited from their dam. So we could look at 40 traits times 30 chromosomes times sire and dam. We could be looking at close to 500 numbers from every bull. So we don't want to do that, obviously. So what should we look at? And this is where I want to emphasize that I think commercial producers in particular really need to focus on looking at having confidence in a good selection index and using that selection index as their first threshold, and then maybe a couple other traits after that that are particularly of interest to their herd. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at an example for protein yield and how that's calculated, because I want producers to understand that these aren't weights that we just kind of willy-nilly throw on these different traits. But there's actually a process that we go through to decide how much emphasis we want to put on each trait in these indexes. And I'm going to use protein yield as an example. So what USDA scientists have done is estimated the value of a pound of protein over the last several years and projected what they think that'll be in the future. And I've actually got a little bit of a typo here. This is supposed to be $2.48 per pound rather than $2.28. So I've got it correct down here, but there's actually a little bit of a typo right here. So $2.48 per pound is their protein price projection. However, to get that additional pound of protein from our cow, we're going to have to feed her a little bit more. So they estimate that to be about $0.90 per pound of protein in additional feed. And we've got to take care of her a little bit better, and that's going to cost us another $0.09 or so. So we come down here, we take our $2.48 per pound, we subtract our feed cost, we subtract our additional health cost, which gives us about $1.49 in revenue per pound of protein after considering those two things. But then a bull's daughters, we expect to be in the herd for about 2.78 lactations. So we multiply our $1.49 by 2.78, and that gives us $4.14 per pound of protein. Okay, so this is for the lifetime net merit formula and the values that we derive for lifetime net merit. So the point is that it's based on what we expect the economic conditions in the dairy industry to be. And so that's why net merit is a good starting point for commercial producers. Now, obviously, there are fluctuations in milk price, and they tend to go up and down a little bit, so it's never perfect, but it does give you at least a good starting point. So then we do this for all of these different traits. So 1 pound of PTA protein we just derived was $4.14. A pound of fat, on the other hand, is worth about $3.22 because we all love ice cream and butter, of course. Milk yield, we actually put a slight negative weight on milk yield of about half a penny or so per pound of milk, because we've taken the fat and the protein out, and what's left over, we have to haul that water to the plant, and so we actually put a negative 1% of our emphasis on milk yield. PL is productive life, and we put about 19% of our selection pressure on selecting for cows that live longer. When we combine udder and somatic cell score together, that's the emphasis we put on maintaining resistance to mastitis, and that's about 15%. We put a small weight on feet and legs. We actually put a negative weight on body size because big cows eat more. About 10% of our emphasis is on different fertility traits, daughter pregnancy rate, cow conception rate, and heifer conception rate. And then about 5% of our emphasis is on calving ability. So let's compare the lifetime net merit index over here on the right to indexes from the Holstein Association, Jersey, and Brown Swiss Associations. And as you can see, the breed associations tend to put a little bit more emphasis on protein yield than lifetime net merit. And part of that is they're looking at, in the future, where can I best position my breed to have strong numbers in the future? And particularly for Jersey and Brown Swiss, they see that as in producing lots of protein. But we have to take that additional emphasis on protein has to come from somewhere. So we tend to put a little bit less emphasis on fat and a little bit less emphasis on productive life in order to get that additional emphasis on protein yield. Holstein Association, they put a little bit of emphasis on, more emphasis on protein yield, and also on some of their type traits, udders and feet and legs and so forth. So if we're compromising on productive life a little bit in order for these other indexes, what does that really do to the economic value of how we're selecting our cows? And one of the things that I want to tell you is that for some herds, having a little bit less emphasis on productive life is probably okay. Now, this shows you the distribution in productive life for young bulls as of August of 2015. And you can see the typical bull's daughters, based on our projections, should live almost 5 months longer. And not just live 5 months longer, but be in the dairy herd producing milk 5 months longer than daughters of an average bull born in 2010. And the question is, in an economic environment where beef prices are high and we're turning our herds over quickly, is that really realistic or not? Some of these bulls out here, we would expect to live almost a lactation longer. And so some people have suggested that maybe those productive life numbers are either a little bit inflated or maybe a little bit unrealistic. And so in those situations, maybe those breed association formulas make sense for some producers. And to some extent, I agree with that, but there's one group of herds that I want to emphasize where maybe that's not entirely true. And that's because productive life, in addition to telling us how long cows remain in the herd in general, does a really good job telling us when cows leave the herd and why cows leave the herd. And so in some of our dairy classes, we always tell the students, I don't really care what a herd's culling rate is per se, but I do care about why they're losing cows and when their cows leave. And so the number one reason we never want a cow to leave the herd is because she died. Because if she died, we don't get a beef check, we get a bill to dispose of her instead. And so high productive life bulls have daughters that are much less likely to die. So this was a study that we did in 2012. And we split our herds into herds that really struggled with mortality. More than 7% of their cows annually were dying versus herds with really low mortality, less than 3% of their cows died annually. Okay, in the low productive life bulls, you can see in those herds that struggle with mortality at a 9% mortality rate versus the high had less than 7%. So in those particular herds, a trait like productive life is really valuable. It was valuable and did reduce our mortality rate in the low mortality herds as well, but not to the same extent. We also don't want cows to leave during the first 60 days of lactation because we've still got a lot of milk to harvest from those cows. And because if they're leaving early in lactation, that means that there's probably a health reason associated with that. So this was looking at what percent of our cows leave in the first 60 days in our last two columns here. And you can see, again, low productive life bulls, 7.5% of their daughters were leaving in the first 60 days in herds that struggled with mortality versus less than 5% in the high productive life category. So productive life is really a valuable tool to help us have cows leave the herd when we want them to leave the herd and for the reasons we want them to leave rather than some involuntary reasons. In terms of also selecting for cow health a little bit, so productive life is one really valuable tool that we have for herds that struggle with health. There are some other traits that are useful as well. We're looking at mastitis resistance here, and the way that I've scaled mastitis is a tendency of a bull's daughters to have more mastitis. So in this particular instance, a high number is unfavorable because it means more mastitis. In the future, I think we'll start to see people represent that the other way, where a high number would be more resistance. So you just have to keep that in mind. The way that I've scaled this and presented it is a high number means a higher incidence rate. Okay, and you can, as you can see, there is a slight relationship. As we get higher udder depth scores, the incidence rate of mastitis goes down. As we get higher somatic cell scores from our sires, the incidence rate goes up. So our goal is to find those bulls that kind of are high for udder depth, low for somatic cell score, and generally speaking, those daughters are going to have less mastitis. For some other traits, for example, I'm going to show you ketosis resistance. Again, a high number means more likely to have ketosis. The low number means less likely to have ketosis. And one of the traits that I want to point out to you is dairy form. A high score for dairy form means that a cow tends to be very angular and thin. And those cows that tend to be angular and thin aren't able to maintain body condition after peak lactation, and they lose a lot of body fat, and so they're more susceptible to ketosis. Now, most producers, when they look at their bull book, they look at the arrows pointed to the right in the linear trait column, and they think that's a good thing. For dairy form, that's not the case. Those cows that are really angular and thin tend to have more mastitis, more ketosis. And then here on the right-hand panel is our productive life trait, and you can see bulls with high productive life, their daughters tend to have less ketosis. So here's an example of a bull low for dairy form, high for productive life, and that gives us great ketosis resistance. At the other end of the spectrum, up at the top, is a bull who was low for productive life, high for dairy form, and that bull was one of the poorer for, and in fact, in this particular data set, was the poorest for ketosis resistance. So there are some things we can do to breed for healthier cows in our commercial herds and herds that struggle a little bit with cow health. And what I want to do is to also look ahead at the future a little bit and mention that we are likely to have genomic evaluations for some of these health traits in the future. So for instance, this was a research trial in 2013 that looked at producer-recorded health events. So these were producers that were using a herd management software such as PC Dart or DairyComp. And then they extracted those producer-recorded events from the herd software and did a genetic evaluation. And with genomics, asked what kind of reliabilities can we get with really a fairly small data set. This was about 275,000 mastitis observations, for instance. and that gave them a respectable reliability for mastitis resistance of 40%. Now, that's not what we're used to looking for production traits. We're talking 80, 90, 95% reliabilities. But that's based on millions of cows. This is 275,000 observations, and we're getting reliabilities of 40-some percent, and we would expect that we would get many more than 275,000 observations if we were able ever going to do some sort of national genetic evaluation for cow health. And I think because of genomics, those opportunities are going to be available real soon, so producers will be able to select more directly for healthier cows. And what that will allow producers to do is do just a little bit better job matching the genotype of the cows to their herd environment. One thing that we have to be careful about is that we're still, most producers tend to breed for extremes rather than breeding for optimal. So, for example, this is a absolutely fantastic cow. She just set the world milk production record, 74,000 pounds of milk from a farm in Wisconsin. She is a terrific cow. We would all love to have cows like her. But the problem is, if we put that kind of cow in an environment where she's not, doesn't have the right nutrition, doesn't have the right health care and health management, doesn't have the right reproductive management, those types of cows just are not going to do as well. So we have to be realistic about our management systems. And let me just give you an example of one research trial where we split the herds into high and low dry matter refusals. So we looked at, basically, we went and looked at how much feed is left in the feed bunk. And we split the herds into two groups, those herds that had above average amount of feed left in front of the cows after in the morning before they actually did feeding versus those where maybe the bunks had run out of feed for those cows. Okay, and then we compared that to how much milk did the daughters of bulls make compared to how much was expected. And these are our sire regression coefficients. And what we expect here is a 1. A 1 means that we got the genetic response that we predicted. Less than 1 means we didn't get as large a response as predicted. And greater than 1 means we got an even larger response than predicted. So in those herds where there was lots of feed left in front of the cows in the morning, we got basically 100% of what we expected. A little less than that for fat yield, a little more than that for protein yield, but overall we're getting the response that we expect. However, those herds that were trying to save on feed costs and not waste any feed only got 35 to 40% of what was expected. And we can come up with other scenarios where matching genotype to environment is also really important. So for instance, I've got an old barn with kind of smaller size stalls. I don't want to be selecting for cows that are huge that won't fit in my stalls. So there, if one area where I think commercial producers really need to be involved with their genetic selection decisions, they need to start by looking at the top of an index, and then they need to say, okay, what fits my herd management the best? Is it the very best milk producing bulls in the world, or do I need to focus more on productive life and fertility and those types of traits? In those particular herds that didn't feed their cows well, what I'm showing you here is how it related to body weight. So those cows, those herds that didn't feed their cows enough, the correlation between body weight and milk yield was extremely negative. And so basically what that meant was that the big cows were heavily penalized in those types of environments because they need a lot to eat. They're bigger, they have more mass to maintain. If they didn't get enough to eat, then they put their feed towards growing first and didn't have enough left over to really produce as much milk as they should have. The same was true of fat cows as well. Those cows that were genetically inclined to be fat, they wanted to lay down some fat first before they directed nutrients towards milk production, and so there was an unfavorable relationship there. So in those particular herds, they would have been much better off having somewhat smaller cow size because they weren't willing to feed them enough to maintain the large cow's nutrient requirements. Okay, so my take-home messages for today, I've covered a few different types of things, but I've got just a few take-home messages in one on the next slide as well. And the main thing is that commercial producers need to be focused on using good sires. If you're involved in marketing, you have to use young sires because that's just the way it is in the genomics era. You're going to have some hits and misses. You're going to spend a lot of money to hopefully make a lot of money. Some people are going to be lucky in that regard, and some are going to spend a lot of money and not get the return that they had hoped. Commercial producers, on the other hand, it really doesn't matter so much whether they're using young bulls or daughter-proven bulls. They're both great options, and they just need to make sure that they're picking the bulls that fit their system and using from the top of the list. I do want to throw in that I don't think we're quite at the point where I'm comfortable comparing a young sire proof to a daughter proof and bull proof, because there does tend to be some slippage in those young sire proofs. A lot of that has been adjusted for, and we're getting closer, but we're still not quite there yet. So compare daughter proof and bulls to daughter proof and bulls, young sires to young sires, and pick from the top of the list. This bull here is a bull named Penn State Ivanhoe Star, so I like to put him in, picture of him in there. He's daughter-proven, but he was daughter-proven in the 1970s, so that's not the type of bull we want to use. So we have to be within reason, but I think a good proven bull near the top of the list is still a good choice. For commercial producers, let's start with a selection index, just to simplify the process a little bit and make sure we're focusing on those traits that are most important to us. And then lastly, we want to match the genotype of our cows to our herd management level. If we are a herd that struggles a little bit with cow health, we've got mortality rates 7, 8, 9, 10%, we really want to be focused on bulls that are high in productive life. We want to avoid those extremely high dairy form sires, and net merit will help focus us on that particular subset of bulls more readily than, for example, Holstein's TPI formula. So for those types of herds that really need to focus on cow fitness levels, I recommend that they start with net merit. For herds that maybe don't have quite as much concern over health, they have a 2, 3, 4% mortality rate, and they can afford to focus on maximizing production, and they've got a nutrition management system and a health system and reproductive management that can maintain high production, then a little bit less emphasis on productive life is probably appropriate, and some of those other indexes are a good place to start in those particular cases. So again, it's about matching the genotype of your cows to your herd management system and using the best bulls that you can. Okay, so that covers what I had hoped to get through today, and thank you for participating and joining in, and I would be happy to answer any questions that folks might have.
Okay, thanks a lot, Chad. That was a very good discussion on sire selection. We have one question that's come in, and the question is, when you looked at herds with higher cow mortality, did you determine if the cows died or were they euthanized because they could not be sold? And the reason that they could not be sold would be because of antibiotic treatments or they were not ambulatory?
That's a great question, and we didn't have that level of detail in our data set. So it was, it's both. It's cows that died versus and cows that are euthanized.
Okay, thanks. You mentioned that, talked about using a selection index as your primary selection tool, and then commented about maybe making some secondary selection on a few other traits of interest. Do you have any kind of guidelines, if the person picks two or three traits, kind of guidelines on how to make, sort through bulls and make selections on those secondary traits?
Yes, that is a great question, and it really fits in well with the idea of that's your chance to match your genotype of your cows to your herd management system. So that's where some herds need to be looking at productive life, daughter pregnancy rate, somatic cell score, if that's those are areas they need to really focus on cow health and reproductive performance. And another herd maybe, because, the the point is that because protein yield and fat yield are in the index, there's not going to be any bulls at the top of the list that are horrible for protein yield and fat yield. So now I can pick from the top. I can really tailor the genotype that I want for cows that are a little bit easier to manage as well. On the other end of the spectrum, I'm a herd that's not really too worried about the health of my cows. I've got a great somatic cell score. I want to try and push for those world record cows or a 40,000-pound herd average or whatever the case is. Those herds probably want to look at the top of the index and now start to focus in on those that have high PTAs for the yield traits. So that's where, so we start at the top of the selection index, and then we ask ourselves, what kind of cows are going to work best in my system? Maybe I need a little bit smaller cow. Maybe I need cows that can withstand a little bit lower input environment in terms of the types of stalls aren't as comfortable and so forth. Or maybe I'm trying to really push for the elite production levels. So great question.
Okay. I have one other question that I wanted to ask. Talked about a lot of the production and health fitness traits. How much you incorporate management of inbreeding into your sire selection decisions?
That's another great question, and an important one. And we now, even with genomic testing, we can even predict genomic predicted inbreeding and really do a good job of trying to control inbreeding at the herd level. So it's something that ideally we want to pay attention to. If you're working with a bull stud or a breed association to do your matings, they've incorporated those types of inbreeding calculations into when they do their matings to help you avoid inbreeding to some extent. So that's great, or else you have to do it, kind of pay attention to yourself. The other thing about genomics that's been helpful is that it's given us just a little bit of a cushion, because the reality is that we can't completely avoid inbreeding. But what we've been able to do is to find some of those genetic recessives that cause problems associated with inbreeding, and we can avoid those a little bit. And so that'll help us, even as inbreeding creeps up a little bit, to avoid some of the negative consequences of inbreeding. But with that said, they don't catch everything, and there are some small, subtle effects that maybe don't result in the death of an embryo or a stillborn calf and so forth that do impair the fertility of our cows down the road and their general health and thriftiness. So certainly, you're best off having a group of bulls and then mating your cows based on either through a bull stud or breed association trying to minimize inbreeding on each individual mating level. Not all herds do that. Some herds use the bull of the day, and obviously you're taking risks when you do that. So it's a risk management tool to try to avoid inbreeding if you can.
Okay. I have another question that came in, and it says, does it make sense for producers to compile their herd average for all traits to see where their weaknesses are?
Yes, I think it does. And I'll give you an example. I grew up on a small farm in New York, as you mentioned at the beginning, and we had horrible fat percentage. And we always debated whether it was something that we were doing nutritionally or was it something that just the bulls that we picked just happened to be low in fat yield. And I don't know what the answer was. And we tried to address it by changing our bull selection a little bit, but then I graduated from high school, so I'm not sure what, can't answer the question. But the point is that, yes, it does make a lot of sense to do that. And in fact, I think that's one of the advantages for commercial producers to do genomic testing in their herd. I'm not necessarily one who thinks that we need to genomically test every heifer calf to make culling decisions about those calves. But I do think that if you do some occasional genomic testing in commercial herds, you'll find out kind of where you stand, and that will help fill in that blank a little bit and help you understand, do I need to make some management changes in this area, or do I need to start changing my genetic selection parameters in this area a little bit?